Ministers, ladies and gentlemen, friends, welcome to the International Transport Forum 2010, here in the beautiful historic city of Leipzig, which for hundreds of years has been at the hub, the transport and the trade hub of Europe. And transport and trade have brought prosperity to Leipzig and given Leipzig its place in the world. So where is the ITF here in 2010? What is the ITF's place in the world? Well, the big theme for the forum this year, your conference, is innovation, transport and innovation. In other words, you have a platform, you have an opportunity, all of you here, to exchange ideas, to think the unthinkable, to brainstorm, and I give you permission to do this, to argue, to test your ideas against each other. Argue in a friendly spirit, please, ladies and gentlemen. We have a jam-packed opening plenary session for you, fizzing with ideas, innovations and innovators to delight you and to provoke thought. So, don't sit passively. Please take part. Get your questions going. Write them down and share them with us at the end of this session. And to get us going, in the spirit that we intend to follow, I give you the ITF Secretary General, Jack Short, for the opening address.
Good morning, Minister Merrifeld, Minister Morlok, Secretary Bomba, ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to you all to our third International Transport Forum in Leipzig. Our forum takes place at a very challenging time, with many confusing and even contradictory signs on the health of the world economy. On the one hand, there are signs of economic growth picking up, with positive effects on a transport sector that was hit very hard by the crisis. On the other hand, the state of the public finances is so parlous that there is enormous uncertainty about future investment and spending, especially in our sector. But notwithstanding this uncertainty, recent events have underlined again the important and central even role that transport plays in modern life. We're dependent on transport and we take it for granted. And this dependence is not going to weaken. In a fast-changing world, transport, therefore, must adapt, must change, and must improve, that is, innovate. There's certainly a perception that transport does not perform as well as other sectors in innovating, and no doubt we'll hear your views on whether you think that's true or not. Nevertheless, the sector has a strong tradition of innovation, and its innovations have facilitated trade, have fostered industrial change, and have allowed the integration of peoples. And innovations don't have to be complex. Two of the greatest innovations of the 20th century, the container and the seatbelt, have been extremely simple innovations, but have had profound impacts on our sector. But there are many other innovations, like the invention of the jet engine, logistics software, and over 600 incremental improvements to the car over its century of existence. And there are many recent innovations. These include GPS-based information systems for public transport and for car users. And I suppose you will agree that we are just at the start of innovations coming through mobile phones and the internet. And of course, we discuss technological innovation, but policy innovation is often less discussed and is perhaps the greatest challenge for us. And what are the sector's most important policy innovations? I'm sure you can discuss that. Is it deregulation? Is it pricing? Is it something else? We have an opportunity for you to discuss all these things, and we have a programme that will invite you to think about all the aspects of innovation. We have also fascinating examples from imaginative people who are taking great risks to bring innovation into being. Mr. Piccard's solar plane, Mr. Lowe's of Skysails, and tomorrow we have a 17-year-old from Korea, schoolboy, who has invented a mobile phone application for public transport. There will be opportunities for all of you to get involved in the sessions today, tomorrow and Friday. And we want to know your views, and we want to ensure that all the views are heard. We also want to ensure that in this opening session, the key questions are put on the table. From our point of view, these include: which kinds of innovations can be left purely to the market? Which are the innovations that need to be steered, to be pushed, to be encouraged? And how can we do that once we want to push them or steer them? And the aim is that over the next 2.5 days, we will try and provide at least partial answers and better understandings of these questions. So, for this event also, ladies and gentlemen, there's a wealth of background information. It's on the web. We've also issued several new publications, new data, and a new transport outlook to correspond with the forum. So you can please go to the stand and talk to the staff and see these new outputs. I would also ask you to take the opportunity to visit the exhibition here in front of the building and also in Augustusplatz, where we also have some exhibition. So you have great opportunities to exchange ideas and pick up some new ideas, I hope. So once again, thank you all very much for being here. We wish you a stimulating and enjoyable and useful event. I'm very pleased now to invite the chairman of the International Transport Forum, Minister Rob Merrifeld, to open the forum.
Thank you very much, Jack. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great privilege for us to be here to welcome you to the 2010 International Transport Forum. And on behalf of the Government of Canada, I want to state just how honored we are to be holding the presidency this year. And I especially want to extend my sincere and great thanks to the German host for the warm welcome to the beautiful city of Leipzig, this international and the International Transportation Forum Secretariat, for their efforts in organizing this unique and important event and opportunity for all of us. Germany, by the way, is the natural location for this forum. For the forum, and after all, you realize that some of the greatest inventions have come out of German technology. You know, the invention of the diesel engine, the invention of the rotary cylinder engine, and you know, do you realize the very first modern automobile was created by Carl Benz? I thought it was Henry Ford, but he was the one who actually just made money on it, I think. So it is great that you're here with the passion that will inspire you from being in this place where innovation has started many years ago. It's interesting how innovation will change the challenge us all in today and to be able and tomorrow for helping us to get to creative ways to be able to find solutions to many of the problems that we have around the world. This time last year, we were going into a major recession at this forum. There were a lot of very nervous people in the room. They didn't know how deep it was going to be, how long it was going to last. And we saw a considerable meltdown in the economies of the world, the worst since we've seen since the 30s. But we're not, one example and one thing that we have learned out of the experience of this last year is that we're not islands unto ourselves as any country, that we're all interconnected. And what happens in one place of the world affects all of us in the other areas of the world. And we have to innovate our way out of it. We have to create jobs. We have to create stronger economies, improve our standards of living in all of our countries right across the world. This is a great challenge. We have to solve the problems, seize the opportunities that are there for us. Innovation is going to help us get there. So what do we mean by innovation? Well, I want to give you a personal example that I ran across very recently. I have a farm in Alberta, Canada, where I grew up. Actually, it's the fourth generation farm. We have farmed about 3,000 acres, and unfortunately, I could be up for child abuse, but I passed it on to my oldest son. And I told him, go get a business degree, and I teach him how to farm. He got a business degree, now he's teaching me how to farm. He bought a new seed drill this year and tractor, and I had the opportunity to ride with him for about an hour as a parliamentarian, and so I got on this tractor. And you realize I got in this tractor, it's three times as wide as the equipment that my father, my grandfather, myself used. GPS ran, so it's ran by satellite. He doesn't touch the steering wheel. It drives down the field by itself, and it's three times the width, and it's within an inch of being accurate. That's technology. That's innovation. We have to do that right across every sector of our economy. And do you realize that innovation is not an option? It's compulsory. You either do it or you'll be left behind. So this forum and what we're doing here today is very, very important. We have to move from a stimulus-driven economy that we've seen in this last year to something that's sustainable growth that is real, that our GDPs of our countries grow not because of going in debt, but because of actual productivity. And we have to increase productivity in every area and every facet, and that's where transportation comes in, that's where innovation comes in. Canada, we have another example where we were able to work together with partnershiping on all facets to be able to drive that kind of innovation into our sector. We worked very closely with what we call the Asia-Pacific Gateway. Asia-Pacific Gateway is an investment of dollars by a federal government into the west coast of Canada to move products from the interior of Canada out to the west coast and into the Asian market. And it started by putting partners together. It started by working to make sure that we not only put bricks and mortar in place, but we innovated in ways that built for success long term. And this was so successful that in the middle of a recession last year, we actually grew the productivity of those ports and the amount of products that moved in and out. Because you could have the best port in the world, and it can be the most efficient, and it can have the most innovative ways of being able to move products from shore to ship, and it wouldn't get you where you need to go. You can have the best train systems, the best infrastructure on road systems to get to the port, and that wouldn't necessarily be the total solution either. You have to have the most innovation down at the farm level, at the factory level, to be able to be productive, to make sure that you can compete internationally and nationally, and have the good infrastructure to get it to port, have the good infrastructure at the port to get it to the ship and off to market. It is an entire chain. You have to put the customer in connection with the product and get it to market. All stakeholders have to be put together, and that's where governments come in. So what we're talking about here is in innovation is not just talk about innovating product, not just talk about innovating the road structures, the infrastructures, but innovating policies, innovating ideas of how we're going to actually move it. Because we can very easily get trapped into let's say, complacency. And that's why good markets create good jobs create good economies, good economies create strong governments and strong countries. Canada's a success. We haven't trapped the market on success in any ways. We could talk about our national road weather information systems network. We could talk about our aerospace or our rail sector or our cold weather technologies, all of those. But we're not saying that we have any of the answers. We're saying we have maybe perhaps some of the niches that we could help with, some ideas that could help you. We haven't cornered it. That's why Canada strongly supports this forum. That's why it's important that you are here, that you have a platform for exchanging ideas and best practices, that you have an opportunity to discuss with each other the potential that you can create. As you move forward, and as we launch this 2010 forum, I'd like to challenge you. I'd like to say, think this next few days as you go through and you talk to your colleagues in this room from around the world of the opportunity that you have to create the very best international transportation system of the future. And then you have to discern how you're going to move from where you're at to where you're going to go to be able to get to that perfect, perfect transportation system in the future. Now, I finally want to say that I think innovation technology, I think the policies and collaboration all must be put in place to get to that ideal system. And I want you to be challenged and think about that and to seize the opportunity that is here, that is yours, the expertise that is in this room and it's at this forum, take it back and produce a greater tomorrow for you and for your country. Thank you.
Wow, that's a big challenge, isn't it? Strive for perfection. Thank you so much, Mr. Merrifeld, for getting us all to think big and aiming high. As we heard from Mr. Merrifeld, we wouldn't be here without the support of the federal government of Germany, which very kindly and generously sponsors the International Transport Forum. And I would like you to put your hands together and welcome the Federal State Secretary for Transport, Herr Rainer Bomba.
General Secretary, Mr. Short, Minister Merrifeld, my dear colleague Mr. Morlok, ladies and gentlemen, the ITF this year is being held for the third time in this wonderful town of trade fairs. As a representative of the host country and as a representative of the federal government, I would like to welcome you, warm welcome to you. This year we will look into the topic of transport and innovation. This is a big topic for the following reason. Innovation is the crucial key to the solutions and to find solutions to the big questions of the 21st century, especially as far as transport is concerned. Given the international interconnectedness, transport over the next couple of years will grow exponentially. As far as mobility is concerned, there are big environmental challenges, climate challenges, and policy challenges. There are social changes to boot and their impact on mobility behavior. To be future-oriented in transport policies, we have to base that on trailblazing innovations. And those are the very innovations we would like to talk about in Leipzig over the next couple of days with representatives from 52 member states of the ITF. Fields of innovation today and of tomorrow are marked by the following. They basically interconnect different fields and different areas. The first example is the growing interconnectedness of IT and other information technologies. Key is transport telematics. And there is a big potential to be tapped in order to make more efficient use of our burdened and overloaded infrastructure. The combination of traffic guidance systems of our roads and onboard units to connect that with telematic systems in our car, in our cars, represents big challenges, but I'm sure that we are on a good way with those new technologies. And a second example, four key fields of innovation are electric mobility and ways of electric mobility, which comes up to the challenge of being kind to the climate and to our resources. For the time being, we don't know what the environmentally friendly drives of the future will be. But I'm sure by fostering electric mobility, and that means fostering battery technologies as well as fuel cells, we basically put our money in the right basket. And it's all about technology. So, to do research into batteries is as important as doing research into fuel cells and hydrogen drives. However, we mustn't forget about conventional petrol and diesel engines, because again here there is a lot of room for improvement. And diesel engines have matured a lot over the last couple of years. However, no drive technology in the future will be able to be the only drive technology and face up to all the challenges. However, what is important is to find the right mobility concepts in line with the available technology. This is about lowering CO2 emissions in transport, as well as to reduce dependence on fossil fuels. In Germany, for instance, in transport, we consume 30% of our primary energy sources. Only households consume more. For a living, hot water and electricity in our houses, we need about 40%. The aim of the federal government is the following: basically to foster such new technologies and to foster their implementation in transport. Electric mobility is a good example for the following reason. It opens up new fields of innovation, especially the combination of electric mobility and alternative ways of energy offers fascinating new vistas. Just imagine the dweller in a house producing much more energy than it consumes. Just imagine that. And there will be intermediate storage of the additional energy. And when you return home with your car in the evening, or your daughter with her electric bike, they can tap into that additional energy generated during the day. This has been about killing several birds with one stone. We don't pay for mobility. We have a completely carbon neutral driving and living. And it is approaches like that which are not an utopian dream anymore. The zero CO2 energy house has become a reality and has been awarded with lots of prizes. And this shows that it is worthwhile to think about innovation in a holistic way, and that is worthwhile to foster innovation. Ladies and gentlemen, again, we are undergoing big changes, and this is a time of change. As last century, the German Emperor William II said, he said, "I believe in the horse, the car will just be a transitory phase." But ladies and gentlemen, see, our task is to foster that change and to foster that sea change, to shape it actively and to see it as a chance for the future. Identification and development of trailblazing new ideas will make a major contribution to that process. I look forward to interesting discussions here in Leipzig. I hope to hear about lots of new thoughts and new ideas. Thank you very much for your attention.
I'll hear lots of new ideas to get us all closer to those vistas of possibility that you're encouraging us to dream about. You certainly shall. New ideas, new thinking are about reinventing the past, reinventing the way we do things. And a city that has really reinvented itself over hundreds of years is Leipzig. I do encourage you to go and visit the city in your time off and see the way in which it has changed itself from the early Middle Ages to where it is today, bringing prosperity and bringing a thriving way of life to this corner of Saxony. So to give us now a local perspective on the challenges ahead, I would like to invite the Minister of Economic Affairs, Labour and Transport for the Land of Saxony, Herr Sven Morlok.
Yes.
Mr. Merrifeld, Mr. Short, Secretary Bomba, ladies and gentlemen, it is a tremendous pleasure for me to be able to greet you all today here in Leipzig in the Free State of Saxony for the World Transport Forum. Numerous ministers, scientists, decision makers from the commercial sectors are meeting here together in Leipzig in order to exchange ideas regarding the topic transport and innovation, unleashing the potential. Leipzig has historically been quite closely connected to the transport industry, and we've heard from it just at the beginning of the conference from the beautiful lady what happened here in Leipzig in history. As early as 1839, the railway section from Leipzig to Dresden was brought into operation as the first German railway line. The combined metropolitan area of Leipzig-Halle is a historically developed industrial and residential area in the intersection point of important transport axes. The region has essentially become that transport hub with the highest level of development potential for central Germany. Leipzig has developed to become a forward-looking and cosmopolitan city, which, due to its location, has become a significant transport junction in the center of Europe and with easy access to our Eastern European neighbors. Commerce and transport here have always been recognized as a driving force for exemplary development. As a few examples, I would like to mention here the upgrading of the airport, the arrival of DHL, Porsche, and BMW, as well as the new trade fair facilities in which your conference take place. Ladies and gentlemen, transport policy and transport economy have arrived today at a juncture involving huge challenges. The financial crisis, with its consequences for enterprises, banks, and even nations, volcano eruptions, after which the respective ash cloud is able to paralyze European airspace, non-renewable fossil energy reserves, and demographic development have brought serious challenges for our transport systems. With the framework of these current events and long-term developments, it is particularly within the transport sector that considerable tasks now await us. We would like to mutually provide answers here for these challenges. Ladies and gentlemen, in the aftermath of the peaceful revolution in the GDR that began right here in Leipzig with the now famous Monday demonstrations, the breakdown of the wall in Berlin was quickly followed by the fall of the Iron Curtain, which separated Europe. The borders have since been opened, thereby losing their trade as an entity of separation. Many Central and Eastern European nations have become recent members of the European Union. The trans-European north-south connecting lines, which were pushed westwards in an unnatural fashion during the aforementioned period of European separation, are going to return back to their original locations. We would like to accommodate these lines with a new railway connection between Dresden and Prague. Together with our Czech neighbors, we are intensively campaigning for the construction of a high-speed railway between these two cities as a part of a high-speed railway connection between Berlin and Vienna. This connection will be highly attractive for human transport and for the mounting of future challenges regarding the transport of goods, it will be indispensable.
regarding the actual implementation of this ambitious project, we need your liability in planning. Saxony and the Czech Republic are counting on the support of the federal government, Mr. Bomba, and the European Union. Ladies and gentlemen, concerning the drive technology for personal vehicles, there are new and exciting innovations. Great opportunities are arising for sustainable mobility involving electromobility. Electric power systems offers for the transport sector the possibility to vitalize the use of renewable energy and to reduce considerably the impact of air pollution and noise pollution in our cities. The compatibility of mobility and metropolis lifestyle will play a central role in the future transport policies. Saxony has become one of a total of 8 model regions throughout Germany that are funded by the federal government in the continued development and testing of electromobility. The scientific and economic environment that is available in Saxony offers excellent preconditions to help Saxony to become a significant location in the area of alternative power systems and new concepts for vehicles. There's, however, one thing that we may not forget. Parallel to the continued development on electromobility, unabated efforts are necessary regarding the continued increase of efficiency of both conventional vehicle driving systems and eventually for hybrid design. We have nevertheless not forgotten the significance of fuel cell technology. Mr. Bomba had just mentioned it. Federal funding, in our opinion, is meant to be neutral as far as technology is concerned. Saxony is a federal state with a long industrial tradition and one of the historical trailblazers in the development of German automobile manufacturing. The automobile manufacturing industry itself has been a significant branch here in Saxony for more than 100 years. In the automobile state Saxony today, one can find the most modern car manufacturing factories in all of Europe. Excellent managers and enterprises, creative designers, and conscientious employees have grabbed the opportunity. There are thus, in the meantime, more than 70,000 employees in more than 750 enterprises involved in the production sector, the supply industry, the outfitters, and the service enterprises. Modern operational systems in transport matters are, without telematic, ladies and gentlemen, no longer imaginable. In Saxony, we have already telematic systems for transport installed. Decisive impulses for the development of management systems that overlap transport carriers started in 2 research projects in Dresden and Leipzig. Saxony is thus, in this regard, on a sustainable pathway which we must follow in a single-minded and researchful fashion. Research and development are a guarantee in Saxony for continued generation of innovative ideas in various areas of Saxon industry. In 3 universities, 5 technological universities, in the Fraunhofer, Leibniz, Max Planck Institutes and other research institutes in Saxony, there exist more than 50 facilities with the largest variety of specifications with the research topic in the area of automobile technology. Moreover, numerous engineering enterprises have been working on automotive industrial assignments. A significant portion of these assignments is realized through orders for international placed automobile manufacturers and suppliers. Even the Saxony vehicle industry, typically characterized by medium-sized firms, make use of this collaboration with these institutions for first-class development. More than 33,500 students at the aforementioned universities are now receiving top-notch education in the various sectors of vehicle technology. Ladies and gentlemen, I've tried to make clear that your conference has been brought into an environment that is quite interesting and attractive for professionals within the transport sector. I'm also quite sure that the end result will show that innovative and applicable answers regarding the difficult issues in the future of the transport industry will emerge from the politicians, the economic experts, and the scientists represented here. In this sense, I would like to express my desire that all conference participants enjoy interesting professional presentation, constructive debates, and visionary approaches to solutions. Ladies and gentlemen, I wish you a pleasant stay. Enjoy your time here in Leipzig and in the Free State of Saxony. Thank you for your attention.
Minister Morlok, thank you so much. And as we heard from the Minister, the peaceful political revolution in the GDR started right here in 1989, the Nicholas Church, I think. So do go and check that out, because revolutions can happen in many different ways. And we're encouraging you here to think big thoughts, to reinvent, and also to listen to some revolutionaries. Our keynote speaker, our first keynote speaker, embodies the whole idea of being a revolutionary and capturing the public imagination. We've heard in Leipzig about teams of people coming together to work, but what the public really responds to and what gets us going about change sometimes is just a person out there, a visionary. And we have one such person about to address us, Bertrand Piccard, best known, of course, for going round the world in a hot air balloon, now trying to do the same feat with a solar-powered plane. I don't know if any of you caught sight of it out there in the exhibition, a most beautiful vehicle, creature, I should call it, with the most extraordinary wingspan. We're going to hear all about Mr. Piccard's plans to introduce the world to a new way of transport. It's called the Solar Impulse Project. I would like you to put your hands together for a Renaissance man, Bertrand Piccard.
Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I don't believe we need to make a very long speech to realize that we have a great number of challenges for our future. It's not only the financial and economical crisis that everybody is talking about these days. No, it's also the energy, it's the environment, it's fighting poverty. It is also desperately trying to get a better governance on this planet. And how are we going to solve these challenges? Some people believe that we need new ideas. It's not enough. New ideas, that's extremely easy to have. If we all close our eyes here for 1 minute, we will all come back with a lot of new ideas. This is not the issue. The issue is how to go from the idea to the reality. How to go from the dream and the vision to implementation. And for this, I believe that we really have to understand that what we have to learn is not to get new ideas, but much more to get rid of the common assumptions, to get rid of the certainties, to get rid of the habits that keep us prisoners of old ways to think and old ways to act. This is innovation. This is pioneering spirit. And this is what we need if we want to invent a better future. There has been a lot of these common assumptions that have kept us prisoners of the present instead of pushing us in the future. For hundreds of years, it was proven to be impossible to fly until somebody could fly. The Everest mountain was there for millions of years. Nobody had climbed on top, so everybody thought it was impossible until somebody did it. Walking on the moon, only science fiction until 1969. And I personally remember a very high-level scientist who explained to me why it would always be impossible to fly on muscular power. He had calculated that the diameter of the muscles of the arm for a human being is too small in comparison to the muscle of the bird to carry a human body in the air. Well, the problem for him is that the pilot who crossed the British Channel on a muscular-powered airplane used his legs and not his arms. And the legs have a big enough diameter to carry the human body in the air. What does it show? It shows that each time we have convictions, each time we have absolute certainties, we need to change the angle of view in order to find alternative solutions. A nice way to explain about pioneering spirit is the metaphor of ballooning. In a balloon, you are pushed by the wind. You are dependent of the direction and the speed of the wind. And if you want to go in one direction and the wind does not push you there, you will not go either. But what do you learn as a balloonist? You learn that the atmosphere is made out of several different layers of wind, which all have a different direction. So basically, if you want to change your trajectory, you just have to change your altitude in order to get a better wind. And I think it is exactly what we should learn to do in life. In life, we have visions, we have dreams, we have hopes, we have targets. But very often, the winds of life, the situations, the problems, don't allow us to reach that direction. That's why I deeply believe that in life, if we want to innovate, to create, to be pioneers, we have to change our altitude in the winds of life. That means psychologically, philosophically, spiritually, in order to grab other influences, other visions of the world. It will necessarily reorient our trajectory. The problem is that just now, that's a nice metaphor, maybe quite poetic, but still useless. How do we change altitude? How do we really manage to become a pioneer? Well, just understand a little bit better how a balloon works. If you want to change altitude in a balloon, you have to drop ballast overboard. And here you will climb to a higher level. The ballast in a balloon, that's water, sand, food reserves, old equipment you don't need anymore. And when you throw this overboard, you climb higher. Now it starts to be more practical. Because in life, and especially in politics, especially in economy and finance, if we want to change altitude, if we want new trajectory, we have to drop ballast. And we have a lot of ballast in our world. It is called certainties, safety, common assumptions, convictions, exclamation marks, habits, paradigms, dogmas. All these things that usually we want to hold in our hands very strongly when something goes bad because we believe it will reinforce us. It's not true. It doesn't reinforce us. It just makes us heavier. So if we want to invent a better future, we need to identify our certainties and our conviction, throw them overboard, and that means try to do the opposite. I don't mean to say that the opposite of what we already believe will always be better. No. What I mean to say is that if we have a conviction and simultaneously we can envisage exactly the opposite, we don't have anymore just one way to think or to react. We have thousands of ways to think and react in between. This is possible in politics. We can very well take ideas from the left and ideas from the right in order to make our own political program. It's the same for religion, although it's these days a little bit more dangerous, maybe. We can belong to a religion, but at the same time understand the faith and the belief of others integrate it in our own belief in order to have more tolerance and also, of course, to open and broaden our spiritual understanding of life. We can do it for economy, for education of children, for finance, of course, for technology. Why should we believe that we have to continue what the past has brought to us instead of making some paradigm shifts in innovation? If we manage to think like this, if we manage to be a little bit more a balloonist in our pioneering spirit, what will be the result? The future will not be anymore one straight line going in one dimension in one single direction. No. The future in front of us will be made of all the possible lines, going in all the possible directions, at all the possible altitudes in three dimensions. And what will be pioneering spirit and innovation? It will just be when we allow ourselves to move up and down along this vertical axis, explore all the different altitudes, which means all the different ways to think, all the different ways to behave, all the different ways to react, until we find the altitude, that means the way of thinking, that pushes us in the direction we wish to reach. It's not easy. We need advisors, but mainly advisors who have different ideas than us, otherwise it's useless. We need sometimes friends, family members, psychiatrists, psychotherapy. We need for balloons to have weathermen. The weathermen are the ones who calculate the direction of the wind in three dimensions and help the pilot to move up and down to follow this three-dimensional grid, each altitude having another direction. But I have to say that sometimes it's very paradoxal. When I was with Brian Jones, flying around the world nonstop in 1999, there was a moment after 4 days of flight where the weathermen told us, you have to keep an altitude of 8,000 meters and a speed of 60 kilometers per hour. Well, 60 kilometers per hour, if you want to fly 45,000 kilometers, you don't need a computer to see it doesn't work. So we disobeyed. We moved up and down to find better speed. And at 9,000 meters altitude, we found a little jet stream blowing 120 kilometers per hour. And we were so proud that I took the sat phone, I called the weatherman in the mission control room, and I say, hey guys, don't you think we're good pilots up there? We fly twice the speed you predicted. And the answer was brutal. They told me, we never asked you to fly so fast. And before I could say anything, they told me, open your gas valve, move down by 1,000 meters to slow down. And I started to argue. I said, I'm not going to do that. We are in a hurry. We don't have enough gas in the balloon to make holidays over every country we overfly. Let us fly fast. And they told me, you understood nothing up there or what? I said, what do you mean? And they said, well, you have a low pressure system on your left side. So if you move too fast, for 12 hours it will be brilliant. High speed, good direction. In 12 hours you will have reached the front of the low pressure system and you won't go east around the world anymore. You will move counterclockwise around that low pressure system and you will end up in the North Pole. And then they asked me a question that changed my life. They asked me, hey, you're the good pilot up there, what do you really want? You want to go very fast in the wrong direction or slowly in the good direction? And here you understand how important it is to have good weathermen, not just for ballooning, but everywhere in life, especially for governance of this planet. Because what do we see now in our world? We see our world that burns 1 million tons of oil every hour, without counting gas and coal. A world that is changing the climate, destroying biodiversity, leaving incredibly high public deficit for the next generation, who is never going to be able to pay it back. And what's the result for us today on the short term? It's brilliant. We have mobility. We have money. We have energy. We have safety. We have comfort. But for how long? It is obvious that such an unsustainable way of living is pushing us very, very fast into a wrong direction. And we know it. We all know it because it's impossible to open a newspaper without saying that. Why don't we change? Why don't we do something? Well, basically because long-term vision leaves a lot of space for doubts and fears. And we hate that. That means that nobody dares to make the first step, waiting for the others to do it, and at the end nobody moves. That's why we need incentives from government in order to oblige everybody to move at the same time to make the first step. Otherwise, people won't move. I tell you one thing, if we succeeded around the world in our balloon, it's just because we accepted to slow down. We accepted to lose our little jet stream. And I tell you that sometimes it's difficult. When we were over the Pacific Ocean, there was 12,000 kilometers of water. The speed was reduced to 25 kilometers per hour. We knew that without another good jet stream, we would ditch in 10-meter waves and wait for a week for ships to rescue us. And we started to be afraid. But you know, fear is not something bad. Fear is the moment where you disconnect the autopilot in your head, where you are not anymore just driving as usual, just doing the same business as usual, always more of the same. It's the moment where suddenly you allow yourself to be more conscious, more aware that you have something to change. And we change everything. We've changed the altitude, the flight plan. We threw everything overboard to be lighter. We didn't overfly North America as planned. We overflew Mexico, the Caribbean, and so on. And at the end, we succeeded. 20 days in the air, 45,000 kilometers. The longest flight ever in the history of aviation with no engine. No engine needed. But if I show you this picture, it's to show you how much gas we have left in the last two fuel tanks. You see the best on the right side. You see this bottle with a little bit of frost? That's the liquid propane remaining. We took off with 3.7 tons of liquid propane. We landed with 40 kilos. What does it mean? It means that it was the last moment to land. The flight was unsustainable. If the winds had been slower on the Atlantic, if we hadn't found a 234 kilometer per hour jet stream, we'd have ditched instead of making a successful landing. On that day, I made a promise to myself. I made the promise that the next time I would fly around the world, it would be with no fuel at all. It was still a dream, but it became a real vision when the capsule of my balloon was brought officially to the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum in Washington, together with the capsule of Apollo 11, airplane of Charles Lindbergh, the Wright brothers, Chuck Yeager, and so on. And on that day, of course, I was proud. But on the other hand, I started to ask to myself, there are 11 million people coming in that museum every year to see the past. What are they going to see in the future? In one generation, what will be in the museums? Well, there will be these old milestones, aircraft of the past, but there will be a lot of other things. There will be everything we take today for granted. There will be our cars. There will be our airplanes. There will be our heating systems. There will be our aircons, our computers. There will be everything that today we use because we believe it's normal, but it will be prohibited in the future because it pollutes too much, or it's just going to be unaffordable because of the energy that it requires. And there will be millions of people who will be laughing because they will understand that for 100 years, an entire society has based everything on a limited quantity of fossil energy with a price that could only go up when there is already today so much renewable energy possibilities with an unlimited quantity and therefore a price that can only go down. Basic economical rules that we forget when we get in high positions in this world. I made the promise that there would be a solar-powered airplane in that museum that would show that already today we have the technologies and we have the innovation needed to fly around the world with no fuel. And I think it fits quite well with the challenges of the 21st century. In the 20th century, Humankind has conquered the world. Now it's conquered. It's done. People have gone on the moon. That's done. The future is about new impossible things, new paradigm shifts. And I believe the most interesting one, because it's the most difficult one, is to get rid of our dependency on fossil energy. Why that? Of course for nature. Of course for the environment. Because we know it's important. But it's not enough. Absolutely not enough. For 40 or 50 years, the green parties have showed us this type of pictures of pollution. It did not change the world, because the answers given by the green parties very often were wrong. The answers were reduce mobility, reduce transport, reduce industry, reduce comfort, and nobody wants that. So nothing moved. And in Copenhagen, where I was with the Swiss delegation, it was obvious that people were just presenting the problem of climate change and the cost to solve it, instead of understanding that the origin of climate change is the dependency on fossil energy, and that there are so many solutions that are completely profitable to earn money and at the same time reduce climate change. This is why that type of pictures, I believe, are much more interesting. The price of the oil going up. The price of all the energy going up. Uranium. Look at this curve. Quite a nice curve. Look at this one. You know what this is? The shares of General Motors on the stock exchange market. Price of energy, shares of General Motors. It is clear that if the car industry was obliged to reduce the fuel consumption, in 5 years they would do it. And if General Motors had been obliged to do it 5 years ago, they would not have gone bankrupt this year or last year. And they defend themselves because they say, oh no, you know, it's only about the financial crisis. Wrong. The biggest loss of General Motors is in 2007, when there was absolutely no economical crisis. It was just the year where the price of the oil was at the highest, $147 a barrel. This is why all technologies, the lack of innovation, the lack of pioneering spirit is dangerous, extremely dangerous. Not just because it makes a couple of short circuits, no, because it ruins the potential of our society. And the result is poverty, unemployed people. So, of course, we can say, oh, this is on the other side of the world. Who cares when we live in Europe? Can you imagine that this is in France? These are houses built by homeless and unemployed people. And poverty is more and more present in the rich countries, destroying the purchase power, destroying the growth, destroying our potential. Well, we have other means to produce energy and to make very clean transport. There are solar power, photovoltaic. There is thermal solar power, which works already extremely well. And Deutsche Bank is also involved in the funding of this type of projects in Africa. Insulation of buildings. Very easily, you can get more return on investment when you insulate your building or your house than putting your money on the stock exchange market. You get between 12 and 20% if you return on investment if you insulate your house. You can produce energy with wind, with wood, with biomass, with geothermal. You can have hybrid engines that keep the same comfort, the same speed, the same safety, but with the half of fuel consumption. This is a picture I like. It's maybe not yet the most efficient building, but it's built in Bahrain, a country exporting gas, and they know more than anybody else that the period of cheap fossil energy is over. We have to diversify. How can we speak about that? How can we really speak of innovation with a way to create enthusiasm to the people and not fear and doubt? You know, people are fed up of hearing bad news. Because at the end, when they see millions of tons of oil in the Gulf of Mexico, they don't care too much of spilling a little bit of oil in the wasted water in their city. People are fed up. People need to have enthusiasm, need to have dream, and need to have hope. And this is what we try to achieve with the Solar Impulse Project. If we can fly around the world in a solar-powered airplane with no fuel, nobody will be able to tell at the end that it's impossible to do the same for cars, for heating systems, for air cons, for computers, for electrical lamps, and so on. So, of course, there were already, and you know it, some solar-powered airplanes in the past. It has always remained an anecdote because they had no storage capability. They did not have any batteries. So basically, they could fly only in the full sunshine, and each time the night was coming, they had to land. So they showed the limit of renewable energy much more than the potential. What we want to do is to fly day and night to solve that paradox of capturing solar energy with solar photovoltaic cells and simultaneously run the electrical engines and store the energy in the batteries in order to be able to spend the night in the air on the batteries. An advisor of us, Alan Kokudi in the US, could do it. The 4-meter wingspan model, flying 48 hours in a row, remote control, no pilot. Quite nice, but if you want to capture the imagination of the people, I believe you have to put a human being in. So if you want to go from a remote control airplane to an airplane capable of carrying a passenger or pilot, it's not 4 meters anymore in wingspan, it is 64-meter wingspan. In order to have the surface for the solar cells and the aerodynamic efficiency, and fly also slow enough in order to be able to fly with so little energy. Why that? Because if you count all the losses between the solar cell and the prop, you get for 1 square meter roughly the half of an electrical light bulb, 30 watts. With 200 square meters, as we have the same energy than 200 small light bulbs. That means a Christmas tree. So the challenge for our team, for our engineers, is to build an airplane that is light enough with new materials, efficient enough in terms of energy, to fly with a pilot on board around the world, day and night, with the same fuel consumption than a Christmas tree. The test flight, have been done. We have this airplane. The goal will be to fly around the world in 2013, but the first big goal of this year is to fly day and night. The airplane has to take off on its own, without being pulled in the air, just on its own power. Climb to 8,500 meters, 27,000 feet. At the same time, loading the batteries in order to arrive at maximum altitude with full batteries. And there, the pilot will have just one goal, a single goal. Reach the next sunrise before the batteries are empty. And this is the challenge of our world. If the airplane is heavy, if the pilot doesn't fly stable, if the technologies are not optimal, we will not make it through the night and we will crash before sunrise. And in our world, it's the same. If we don't implement the innovations we have, the technologies we have today, we'll never make it to the next generation without a major disaster. And don't believe the people who tell you, we don't have the innovation today. We have to wait to have better technology. It is wrong. We have today the technologies we need to get rid of at least 50% of our dependency on fossil energy. So you see that this airplane flying day and night without fuel is just a symbol. A little bit like on this picture here. This is a painting from Magritte. It's written, this is not a pipe. This is not an airplane. Or at least not only an airplane. It's a symbol of what innovation and pioneering spirit can bring in our world. We're not going to transport 200 people in a solar-powered airplane next year. This is for sure. And probably even in 20 years. But when Charles Lindbergh flew across the Atlantic in 1927 with 2,000 pounds of gasoline on board, and nobody else than himself, because the payload was taken for the gasoline, everybody thought, oh, if we want to fly across the Atlantic, we have to make a pilot license. And 25 years later, there were 200 passengers in every airplane. So the goal of Solar Impulse, the goal of speeches like the one I'm doing today, the goal of making interviews, making events, press conferences around Solar Impulse is just to get more people in the team. Not the technical team, no. but more people who understand that they can implement in their daily life the same spirit and the same technologies than the one we put in this airplane. If we fly around the world and enough people start to be enthusiastic about using new technologies to save energy, then it's going to be a success. So pioneering spirit, a little bit like on this picture here, a frozen window with a rising sun on the other side. Pioneering spirit is like this. We have to go beyond the obvious, on the other side of the ice. This is pioneering spirit. Now, of course, you will always hear people who will tell you it's impossible. Don't blame them. They just don't have the potential to do more than what they do. Try to help them to see beyond the obvious. Try to help them to have more pioneering spirit, more creativity. Otherwise, we'll never move forward in our future. So you see that it's something that is maybe more emotional than completely intellectual and rational. That's why, as a conclusion, I'd like to show you a little film, 5 minutes, of what we have done today during the last 6 years of Solar Impulse. The rest you can see on solarimpulse.com. But through this film, you will see what we have done during 6 years. And maybe while you're watching these pictures, you can ask to yourself, what would you like to do? Which is the ballast you would like to throw overboard? Which is the altitude that you would like to reach in order to obtain the targets, the objectives, the visions that you would like to fulfill? Now you have 5 minutes to deal with yourself. Can you please run the music and the film? Thank you. our world has today all the technologies we need for innovation. Let's push everyone to use them. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bertrand Piccard. I promised you a visionary speech, and didn't we just hear it? My favorite moment was when the plane just took off. It was such a magical moment. Thank you for sharing us that with us. And you know what? We have more ideas like that for you. Up ahead, I'm going to be introducing you to an economist and a transport guru from the University of Lyon, Professor Yves Crozet, who'll be joining us on the platform in a minute or two. I'm going to be introducing you to another academic from the US, from Ann Arbor, who's been working, taking ideas from the university and putting them into place in the real world, in India, in Chennai, where I come from, and in South Africa too. Sue Zielinski, she'll be joining us in a minute. We'll be looking at the world of business from ITS. We have Scott Stewart, I should say IBI Group. We have Scott Stewart, who'll be talking to us about the urban environment. How do we make sure that people move around as they need to using all the technologies of today? And another out there idea for you from Skysails. Have you ever heard of Skysails? There's a fabulous model in the hallway outside, putting an old idea, a sail, onto the front of a ship. We will have for you Martin Loos, a man who decided to put his money into a new idea. We need more people like that, don't we? So I would like you to please come up and join me now, Professor Crozet, Scott Stewart, Sue Zielinski, and Martin Loos. Take your seats. Let me start off by telling you a little bit more about Professor Crozet. He's one of the big thinkers behind the ITF and has written a paper about what drives transport innovation, which is on the website. I've read it a couple of times, being an economics student, as Professor Crozet is coming from an economics background. So we have the marriage of economics and transport. And let me tell you this, like Bertrand Piccard, he believes you need to go slowly in the right direction and not be too obsessed with speed. Professor Crozet, what is the right direction?
The problem is that, conversely to Bertrand Piccard's plane, I am an economist, so I have some dogma, some certainty, some paradigma. And the main paradigma we have in economics is the notion, the concept of generalized cost. That is to say, we have to add the travel costs, the time costs, and the monetary costs. And if we compare the past two centuries and the next decades we are facing, the main difference is that speed will not play the same role tomorrow than yesterday. If we compare the case in the 19th century, for example, when in Saxony you opened a new line between Leipzig and Dresden, the cost of the new railway track was perhaps 10 times the cost of the road for coaches. But the speed on this railway track was 10 times higher than the speed on road coaches. And the traffic was so important in comparison with the traffic on road that the cost was not very high and the speed was 10 times higher. So we observed in the past decades a diminution of the travel cost, monetary cost, and travel time. What we observe now is something like an asymptotic curve for the gains of speed. Speed is very important. If we compare the time, your average speed to come from your office or your home to Leipzig, probably you can calculate. For me, the average speed was 250 kilometers per hour. The time to go from my office to the airport and to cross the security check and then to wait the plane and then the flight to Frankfurt and then another connection and then another flight to Leipzig. The average speed is now at the maximum. It's very difficult to increase the average speed for cars on road for safety reasons and for environmental reasons and so on. It's very difficult to increase the average speed for high-speed train. It's very difficult to increase the average speed for planes because we are sure that we will not have more and more supersonic planes in the future. So what we are facing now is the fact that we have no more gains for speed. And in the same time, as explained by Bertrand Piccard, we will have a more and more expensive energy. So the difficulty is now to face this new challenge. And the new challenge is not to wait for more and more speed, but to unleash the potential. It is the title of our seminar. To unleash the potential, we have to look at the way to improve the time we spend in the transport system. To improve the time you spent in the transport system to come to Leipzig, the average speed of plane is not very important. What is important is, do you have the possibility during your waiting time in the airport to check your email on your BlackBerry? Do you have the possibility to reduce the congestion time between your office and the airport? Do you have the possibility to reduce the time to check the security system? And to unleash this potential, what is important now is less and less in the on the track or in the infrastructure, less and less in the vehicles, but more and more around the track, around the vehicle. So if you observe the titles of the panel sessions this afternoon, for instance, you have panel sessions about seamless passenger transport, about intelligent infrastructure, about sustainable mobility. And then the challenge we are facing is to understand that speed is now at the maximum and we have only to reduce the cost of energy if possible and not to reduce mobility, because speed is very important at this present level to offer a very high level of mobility for passengers and good. But to understand that the change in the second derivative of the speed gains curve is now the main challenge we are facing.
Thank you. Did you all understand that? The second dimension of the speed gain curve? Ask Professor Crozet later, what do you mean by the second dimension? How do we make sure that we do actually get more speedily to where we want to go without going faster? That is really the challenge ahead of us. I'm going to ask Scott Stewart now, who's MD of the IBI Group, to talk to us about how we live in cities, where most of us live, bringing together technology and old understandings to make sure that our urban environments are more sustainable. How do we make that happen, Scott?
If I can provide some context to the issue of urban environments, the sometime at about when Minister Merrifeld moved from Alberta to Ottawa, 50% of the world population became urbanized, and Minister, you were part of that process. The forecast now is that by 2030, 60% of the world become urbanized. And if you look at a 10% increase over the current of the population of the world, you can see that we're looking at over the next 20 years, hundreds of cities of 1 million people or more being established. And that's not a trend we're going to change, and that's it is happening because there are various benefits associated with urbanization. Cities are typically economic and wealth generators for the country. So we have to accept and we have to adjust for it, and we have to plan for it. And I offer by example a project in a major initiative in Toronto, in the Greater Toronto Area, where the governments have been engaged in a strategic transportation planning exercise for a number of years, and I'm pleased to say that we were part of it. And what was launched out of that was this very integrated, sustainable solution emphasizing public transport and a $60 billion program. And it was going to be implemented over a period of 25 years. The premier of the province endorsed it enthusiastically, and within 3 months of the final report being prepared, he announced his public endorsement of the program. 3 months later, he announced that there wouldn't be enough money, and that there was, instead of the $60 billion, he was going to provide $10 billion, and it was up to the organizations to really find then the $2 billion a year shortfall. So I put that to this organization today and the forum to please help me help Toronto come up with $2 billion a year. Now, we are looking at initiatives. And there's some of the obvious ones. They help us manage the networks better, and they include the application of technology. And it's the application of technology to maybe charge in a different way for the use of our infrastructure. Road user charging, we've seen excellent examples of that in Stockholm and London. We anticipate greater charging for greenhouse gases, carbon footprints. There have been trial demonstrations of variable charges as for car insurance. There are other new initiatives for that we can see for paying for electric energy. So you can imagine all of these different charges that will be applied, or incentives that might be applied to urban environments to affect and alter and manage how people then travel. So we see that as certainly a major initiative, a revenue stream in one hand, but also a method of managing our demand profile. And of course, key to all of that is intelligent transportation systems. It provides a greater ability to monitor networks, to provide traveler information, to use technology in vehicle, to take advantage of smartphone deployment. I'm sure everybody in the audience has a smartphone. About it is the fastest growing technology sector or element now taking place. Something in the order of 23% of the population are anticipated to have smartphones by the end of the year, and it's growing rapidly. So being able to convey information, to be able to use those same smartphones and to address some of these other challenges. The one other comment that I would make, and actually there are two, one is that would be a solution for us in Toronto, and I think it's more universal, is the need for a different governance mechanism for the delivery of transportation. And we really need innovation, and it's innovation of public agencies being able to operate more effectively with and between public agencies, but also public agencies working with private agencies, recognizing the profit motivation of private agencies, but also recognizing that the private sector can deliver to the market solutions in a much, much faster way. The final comment I would make is that is the need to bring closer into the fold the auto sector. There is a real challenge between what the auto sector does and their focus on the consumer, which is understandable, especially if you look at the consumer would spend something in the order of $4,000 or $5,000 a year for private personal transportation or auto travel. But being able to integrate that into then what are the public sector criteria or critical areas of managing networks, providing for safety and providing for better environments. So we have some challenges. And with that, I turn it back to you and look forward to the great advice that's going to be provided to us.
Thank you, Scott, and thank you very much for leading me very nicely into my introduction to our next keynote speaker, who is Henry Z. Lee from BYD, China's big battery company, which is also a young entrant into the auto industry with its electric cars. And Mr. Lee has big ambitions to conquer the world. Why is the future electric, Mr. Lee?
Thank you. Good morning, ministers and ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to be here to share some views, our view about future transportation and the challenges and especially innovations in different fields. A few words about BYD. BYD was founded in 1995, 15 years ago, from 20 people. And today we have more than 150,000 employees, including 10% of them are R&D engineers working on different fields, including telecom, like mobile phones and laptops, and also energy, including rechargeable batteries, solar batteries, and power storage system, as well as automobile, especially with a focus on the electric vehicles studies. So today, one of the hottest topic in the transportation is e-mobility and global-wise. And there's a lot of interest and a lot of institutes have invested in this field. And today we see especially from China perspective, we are facing greater challenges than OECD countries. Because you see all these facts, including the greater increasing demand from the public transportation and private transportation in China, and also globalization lead to more and more intercontinental transport, and also higher living standards in other countries and emerging economies has great demand for transportation. And for China, the energy shortage is one of the main major concerns, not only the CO2. The CO2, we can see there's a great pressure from the global perspective, but for us, the energy shortage is number one pressure, number one question for the governments, because we today, in our total energy, primary energy consumption, about 83% are from coal. And in oil, about 33% of oil for transport, and half of the oil are imported. So these are great challenges to China. And at the same time, the traffic problems in mega cities in China are getting worse and worse. And how to say, air pollution is also famous in China. The many big cities are facing really serious problems with air pollution. Here's just one example, that some data about China's transportation. As an example, that every year during 40 days Spring Festival in China, the people, most of the people moving back home for their reunion, especially the day that people immigrate from the inland to the coastal areas for job, and every year during the Spring Festival, they go back home for reunion. So statistically, in 2009, during 40 days of the peak season, around about 192 million people traveled by train. And more than 2 billion trips made by coach on the road. So this is a huge number of transportation needs. And still you can see the pictures that people are waiting, fighting for a ticket to back home. So this is the reality in China. Maybe it's totally different than developed countries, most OECD countries. And also in Beijing, it's one of the biggest cities in the world, also in China, today have already more than 4 million registered vehicles on the road. In the peak hours in the morning, the average speed of the traffic is roughly 24.3 kilometers per hour. In the afternoon, it's more than 20 kilometers per hour, and it's getting worse. And still, we can see we can forecast that China, the car park is still growing fastly. In last year, 2009, China's car sales already number one in the global market, more than 13.6 million cars sold in China. And we still forecast a strong growth this year, in 2010 and onwards, that by 2020, we estimate the total car park will around 290 million car park in China. That's roughly four times as much as today we have. So this will be a terrible situation that, firstly, where do we get so much oil to support this? If we do business as usual as today, how can we support this demand? Secondly, how can we address these traffic problems and air pollution problems in cities? And also the urbanization in China, that's also a strategy for the government and direction. So that means people also need more transportation. We're glad to see there's some movements in transportation. First one, you can see in the high-speed train project, it's a big project in China that will extend the high-speed rail and rail system by 40,000 kilometers to totally 120,000 kilometers by 2020, including 16,000 kilometers high-speed train. So this is a big project, and this is a very good method to reduce the pressure in the long-distance travel. And secondly, that already 28 cities, especially bigger cities, have approved to build or extend or expand their metro stations, rail station, rail network in the city. So this would also be a great help to lower the pressure of the public transportation. And also these systems are using is electrified. So that means we can reduce dramatically the pollution and the pressure in the city. And thirdly is that the government has set as a strategy for auto industry to promote electric mobility, including electric passenger cars, electric buses, and so on and so forth. And fourth direction is not directly linked to transportation, but it's essentially important as well, that to promote clean and renewable electricity production. Because when we talk about e-mobility, we rely on clean electricities in the future. Even today, with the coal, the electricity from coal, that's already cleaner than combustion engines, but that's not enough. In the future, I think when the energy demand is increasing, we need to think there's an innovation as well to bring more cleaner energy to our life. We have a green dream towards 2020 in terms of mobility. We're assuming that by 2020, the oil cost will be growing more than $120 per barrel, and also the charging stations, which is the biggest obstacles today in promotion electric vehicles, will be in place by 2020. Also, the charging infrastructure in place, battery cost reduction more than 30% in 2020. So all this will help the electrification of transportation. And we boldly forecast by 2020, the hybrid drive will become the basic in the passenger cars, that even you drive with diesel or gasoline, you need to have a hybrid system that could help a lot in the basic reduction of the emissions. And PHEV, which is plug-in hybrid, would take a good chance to have a substantial share in the during 2015 to 2020. So this is a very possibly to happen scenario. And 2020 and onwards, the EV will take a major role in the passenger car transportation, especially in city transportations, which could dominate the market beyond 2020 to 2030. So this is a picture we have in our dream, that as a company, we have a lot of people doing research and innovations. The areas is not only on electric vehicles alone, because it's a big system. from the generation of electricity to transmission, storage, distribution, smart grid, and finally to the end users, electric vehicles. We have to think out of the box for transportation. We imagine a future for our next generations and future generations. More and more green energy will be available for them to power their daily life, including their transportation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lee, and do take a seat there. So electric cars can't do it on their own. What was Mr. Lee talking about over and over again? The whole context, the systems, and that's something that we've been hearing all morning and will continue to do so. I'm going to introduce you now to our next speaker, who's Sue Zaliski from the University of Michigan, based in Ann Arbor, and she is taking her ideas out of the university, out of the rarefied echelons of academia, into the real world, to pilot projects, I think you'd call them. And it's all about new mobility. Now, I don't know what new mobility is. I don't know if you do. Let's find out from Sue what it means.
Well, I think if I had to boil it down in three words, I'd say it's about connecting the dots. And I think what we've seen today, as you've mentioned, that there's so many innovations going on, and they're all really exciting. And they run across the whole gamut. They're not only technologies, they're also new services, they're new products, even new policies and new business models, and basically new ways of doing things. But really, it's not coming together. It's if you can imagine, maybe your iPod doesn't connect to your desktop, doesn't connect to your Google, or maybe your heart and your lungs and your liver and your pituitary gland are not talking to each other. It's sort of like that in transportation right now. We've got all this flourishing of innovations, but it's not coming together in a way that either makes sense for the user or makes sense for our urbanizing world and or makes sense for our economies. So how do we innovate the innovation? How do we connect the dots in sort of a meta-innovation? So you're probably thinking, oh my goodness, let's bring this down to earth before we get too carried away with the meta-innovation. But what you've mentioned is that we're doing living labs or pilots in different cities around the world. And the whole aim was to figure out a way, and Scott alluded to it a little bit, how do we do multimodal, seamless, sustainable, door-to-door, IT-enhanced transportation? And that's not really a media byte. So let's think about it as open source transportation or door-to-door multimodal transportation. So we started, unlike most academic efforts, we started not with the research. We started with reality. We started with the pilots. We're working in Chennai, Kuching, Cape Town, and now Los Angeles, Washington, D.C., Atlanta, Detroit region. And based on this approach of door-to-door mobility, we're trying to imagine a scenario where you would have spaces around a whole region that bring together, physically bring together, modes of transportation seamlessly. So, you know, you could step right off the high-speed rail and get right onto the bus or right into the shuttle or the free bike or the taxi that can take you the last mile home. You can book your car share vehicle from inside the bus, from your iPhone, and you get into the car share vehicle. You drop it off at the next space or hub. And from there, you can, maybe it's a sunny day, you can pick up a free bike and you drop that off at the next space. So basically, it's moving forward all the time in a multimodal system or a way that gives you all these different options. So we started in a kind of a not rocket science way. We wanted to kind of figure out who the players are here because it's beyond the usual suspects. And we also wanted to map out what's already there. So we have a fairly simple, even though the process isn't simple, the steps are fairly simple. We start by bringing people together, convening. And those are not the usual suspects. It's basically we bring together the big business. We're working with Ford Motor Company that's thinking of itself as having used to make cars and trucks, but now makes cars, trucks, and urban mobility, with companies like Cisco Systems, Microsoft, entrepreneurs doing shuttles, doing car share, IT applications for real-time traveler information, doing the virtual cloud, doing integrated wayfinding. And we also bring together people from tourism and social services beyond the usual government suspects, and also some NGOs. And what we do is we say, well, what do we already have? What's working? What are the innovations? And how can we move forward to make this a connected system? So next step is mapping. And this seems really kind of you would be doing this, but what we found is that all the folks thinking about where are we going to put in our plug-in electrics, they're in their labs making their map of where the plug-in electrics are going. The Zipcar folks are in a different place. The bus stop people, the people who are figuring out where the trains and buses are going to go, everything's happening separately. So we decided to do some overlaying, and my favorite story about this is that in Washington, D.C., we're working with the director of planning there. She said, well, how can we prepare? I said, can you overlay absolutely everything, parking lots, corridors, free bikes, zip cars, all of these things, and put a red dot where two or more things already connect? And she came back and she said, you know, that's not going to work because there are way too many red dots. So this was a region-wide map that blew the minds of all the folks at the table, because here we were, you know, the head of transit, the head of IT, people from logistics, they were seeing where, oh yeah, you know, this already connects. There's already a system there that we can now enhance with all of these different new innovations. And somebody remarked that, well, you know, if we just put the signs up there, we have a completely new idea of what our transportation portfolio is, just like our IT portfolio. You put out the map to users, and they say, ah, I'm not a bus rider, I'm not a car driver. I have access to this incredibly hip, sexy, IT-enhanced, system-based portfolio of all the sorts of options that are going to make me free and impress people.
And Sue, I'm going to stop you there, because that's such a cool idea, especially since we're here in Leipzig, really, that you can bring together overlapping red dots, create hubs, and a cool way of putting it, it's a portal into a new way of looking into transportation. Thank you very much. Mapping there. Now, we've seen the overlap, really, from what we've heard from Professor Crozet, Sue Scott, and from Mr. Lee. Our next speaker is going to take us from the urban environment and all that overlap to something completely different. So prepare yourself for Skysails. What is that? Well, we're going to hear from Martin Lowes, who was so captivated by this idea of putting old technology, sails, on the front of ships that he put his own money into backing this business. I give you Martin Lowes from Skysails.
Thank you very much. Nisha encouraged me to speak English, so I give my very best now. Yes, what is the idea? We started in 2001, and 90% of the transport volume is done by shipping. 90%. And the idea is not, say it's not a sail, it's a kite.
Uh-huh.
And it's an important difference, because a kite has a line and a sail has a mast. And when you have a mast and you have wind, you have this drinking, you know. We have a line, we have a kite with a totally different power potential, up to 25 times more than the classical sail. So what do we do? We developed the old technique totally new. Of course, the shipment today, they need it totally automatically. They need a button to press, and automatically it sets to explore it, had to reach the height, and it has to fly. And we fly in figures, doing eights, about 150 kilometers per hour, and have a towing force that has potential to reduce the energy and the CO2 from 10 to 35% depending where you're going, yes, what kind of winds you have. But in average, it's 10 to 35%. And when I met, I could say, like this a bit, this idea, I saw very immediately I'm an engineer and businessman, this tremendous potential. So we developed it from 2001 to now. We're entering into the market now. And of course, it's a long way. Innovation is always a long way. It's not just having this idea and saying, yeah, let's do it, writing it down, building some production lines, and you're going with it. Now it's high tech. And I think a lot of innovations are thinking about trying it out. It is very important for us. We begin very little, just 5 engineers, scientists, trying it out, see what is working, what is not working, trying it again, going back in the theory, and doing this again and again. Then meeting some people, financiers, of course, you said, some more different Wissenschaften, how you say, scientific parts, aeronautical, shipping, the automation, at this very high level. You know, we have now sizes up to 32 square meter kites and forces up to 32 tons of towing force. So that is a dimension that can't be done very easily. So, yes, as Bertrand Piccard said before, I want to encourage, do it. The potential we now feel entering into the market is that great. And to keep all these little humps, all these little daily Widerstände, but to have the vision very clear. Today here are sitting a lot of decision makers, and what for us is very important, of course, that the one who have to do the we have to have a framework, of course, and the ship owners now have to know what kind is going on with the CO2 emissions. Could it be possible that that could be worldwide be implemented for the ship owners as well? And I think to reinforce innovative technology, it is very very important that you now here, the decision maker in policy, will give us a framework that we businessmen and engineers can set it up.
Martin Loos, thank you so much. There's a plea from Martin Loos there to all you decision makers, politicians, policy makers, to embrace his and other new technologies, set standards, and try and encourage this. So are you open to his suggestion or not? At this point, I'm going to say it's your shout, audience. We'd like to hear from you. What do you think are the big questions that need to be addressed at this conference? And I'm going to ask maybe 4 or 5 of you to stand up and not ask a question of our panel particularly, but ask a question of the forum. What do you think the ITF 2010 needs to be addressing? What are the key questions about innovation at this point in time? So, who's going to be my first questioner? Who's going to challenge the forum? I've got a mic here for anyone who wants to speak, and we've got mics at the back of the hall as well. Come on. Okay, we've got someone right at the back of the hall over there who'd like to join us with a question. Can we send the mic across to him? Sir, tell us who you are and why you think your question is relevant to our forum about transport and innovation.
Paul Brubaker from Cisco Systems, and I'm going to let you decide whether it's relevant or not. So, to the panelists, I'm curious. So we know what needs to be done. We know what the problem statement is. But there's a significant disconnect in the structurals, the organizational structures, the problem-solving structures of most ministries, including the governance structure, the legislators, and so forth. How do we reconcile this disconnect with the 21st century challenges versus the 20th century infrastructure that we're reliant on in order to make our decisions and execute policy?
Okay, good question. There is a disconnect. How do we try and link that up? Question number one from Paul from Cisco Systems. Let's have another question. Way back at the back, a lady in a white jacket. Go for it.
Thank you. My name is Gabriele Grimm. I'm senior economist. And I have two questions to all of you. The first one is how to put people first. Always when we look at innovation, it's about technologies. So what are technologies for? It's for us. It's to simplify our life. It's to creating solutions towards problems we have. And we always forget when talking about technologies and innovation about possible risks. If you look at, in fairness, like the Deepwater Horizon we are actually facing in the Gulf of Mexico, we see that innovation has also risks. So we create solutions, but we might create even more worse problems than we were facing before we got this innovation. So how to look at risks also, and how to look at people first, people who want to profit from the solution. The second one is how to get the creativity flowing. It's about the love of life, so about respect of nature, respect of people, respect of what human beings are. And it's about creating the future of our kids. When we look at innovation, we shouldn't forget that it's for the kids of all of us. It's for your kids, it's for future generations. So we should always be aware which kind of vision, which kind of life we want for our kids.
Gabrielle, thank you very much. I'm going to try and bring in some more questions before we end this session. Anybody else want to? Okay, again in the far corner there, we move the mic across.
My name is Peter Fries. I'm from Auto 21 in Canada. I think another key question, there's lots of great ideas and lots of interesting technological innovations being proposed in many corners of the world, but what is the correct role for the public sector? How does the public sector facilitate and bring these ideas to fruition without choosing winners? I think it's an important question of how to move things forward, especially at a time when the world is struggling to pay for things. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Peter, and I think we're going to hear that over and over in the next couple of days. One last question.
I'm Marie-Von Plessis-Fressard, and my question is, following on the presentation of Henry Lee, when we know that the growth of transport demand is going to be in majority in the developing country, how can we ensure that the support to development is not lagging and we do not have a developing country do all the mistakes and have to go through all the technology that have been developed in the OECD country? How can we leapfrog for transport? We've seen it happen for telecommunication. How do we leapfrog transport in order to avoid the immense amount of environmental damage that would occur if we had to go through the same path?
What a very good question to end this little round of questions on. It's not just about the new ideas, but also ditching the bad ones from the past. I'd like to hear from our panelists just briefly now what their final thoughts are in response to the questions that you've put. And perhaps we can start with Henry Lee.
Hello. Hello? Yes, sorry. So maybe I should answer the last questions.
Absolutely. So
as the biggest developing countries in China, have I mentioned that at the same time we have to to meet the people's demand in the public or private transportation. You cannot say you do not drive car, simply do not drive the car, that's not working. So we have to find a way that do not repeat the mistakes, that for sure. So that's why we see a lot of opportunities in innovation in terms of a policy, in terms of management, traffic management, planning, structure, how to structure the whole society with efficient and clean mobility. That's the big task for the government and for the enterprises. So that's the thing we are working on as well. And for example, as a company, we think not only automobile, because we want to sell more automobiles, but should be in a sustainable way. We see 10 years later what would look like in transportation. Should be clean, accessible for most people. So the public transportation is a government's job, like air, train, and metro station. That's not our job. So we are focused on private transportations, like passenger cars. So today we're in the diesel or gasoline. In China, most gasoline. So we have to think electrified. Electrification of the mobility is the main task for us. The key components, key innovations lies in the batteries and electric propulsion systems and control systems. So this is from a technical point of view, that's the focus for the companies. So this clearly, we think that's a chance that to even to lead this innovation. And we think that electrification is not only innovation, it's a revolution. And the passenger private transportation is a revolution. So I think that there's a lot we can learn, but we have to base on the reality in different countries to base on their resource to develop their strategy. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Mr. Lee. The future is electric. I told you he'd say that at some point. How about Scott Stewart? We've been here, I think a couple of questions were about the public sector. We heard from Paul and Cisco System and from Peter about the public sector. Would you like to give us your thoughts on that, perhaps?
The soft underbelly of the problem. Paul, I don't know if there was an easy, there isn't an easy answer. We can, and you in particular would know that we can design technology, create it, deploy it, and if it was all consumer-based or quick decision-based, that we'd be able to achieve a lot of success very quickly. The challenge that I have seen, especially in urban environments and transportation sectors, is the governance challenge. It's the governance of geographic boundaries, of authority, of budgets, of revenue streams, and being able to have public agencies change that governance stream to be able to give up their authority to share with others, be other public agencies or other private agencies, is a very difficult undertaking and probably one of the slowest and weakest parts of the solution chain of what we're talking about in innovation.
I sense some frustration there. Thank you very much, Scott. Professor Crozet, your final thoughts.
Just to comment about the benefit for inhabitants, for people, benefit of innovation. Don't forget that sometimes we have some very exciting innovation, but sometimes we have also some inconvenient innovation and useful from a collective point of view, but not useful from an individual point of view. If I look to the, for instance, GPS, it's very good to have a GPS to locate your car, but it's possible with GPS to control speed and then you receive a fine in the evening. And if we look at the presentation of Mr. Lee, one of the hypotheses was the charging system on infrastructure, on road infrastructure. So it's probably useful from a collective point of view, but from the individual point of view, it's not a very exciting innovation. So the difficulty is that we have to balance between the exciting and the inconvenient innovations.
Yes, you have to make innovation sell themselves, really. Thank you so much, Professor Crozet. Martin Loos, listening to what you heard from the audience, what's your response?
What's my response? The lady who said our responsibility for our children, of course, when you're thinking about climate, about energy,
Ich darf ich mal auf Deutsch wechseln, ist das okay?
Go for it.
Verfügbarkeit ist dann
availability is also a topic, and I think that we have to make decisions now in order to pave the way for new developments, no matter if it's a procedure or a technology. Everything takes longer. I've seen it. We've been developing for 10 years, and now we are at a point where we can present it and apply it. And if we want to accept the challenge, then we have to come up with a decision now, here.
The audience did. And a final word, please, from Sue Zielinski.
So many great ideas. I'm thinking if we are to put the user first and if we're to think about the kind of public policy framework that's going to support that, the role then of public policy needs to be to rethink the role towards providing a framework for removing barriers and providing incentives and moving from the regulation and think tank role into the link tank role. And bringing the right players together, and as Scott said, expanding into what I'm calling public-private innovation, as opposed to just public-private partnership, where you have the private sector at the table early, bringing some of the great innovations, and understanding the question together, as well as coming up with the solutions. And just on that note, I wanted to mention that in India, we are finding that implementation is innovation, because you can talk about these things, but until they are on the ground, they're not really innovations yet. And what we started to see is that in conjunction with the Confederation of Indian Industry, as some of these things are beginning to be implemented, then policy changes. And in the U.S. Experience, that policy is changing towards multiple departments coming together. And this is unprecedented, where we've got the housing department, we've got the EPA and transportation. To me, this is a really hopeful sign. So I'm going to leave it off with a hopeful sign.
Excellent, Sue. And do find out more in the break, which is up ahead from Sue. I shall say thank you to our panelists, Henry Lee, Scott Stewart, Sue Zielinski, Yves Crozet, and Martin Lose, for informing us and provoking us with a series of ideas. You will find in the course of the next couple of days that people will be coming to you with little handheld devices asking you for your ideas as part of a giant brainstorming, a consultation, if you like. And I'm going to read just one of those questions out to you. They will ask you 5 questions. I've got them up here. One of them, for instance, is which mode of transport is most in need of innovation? What do you think? Road, rail, air, or maritime? And all these ideas are going to be put together and shared with you on the last day of the forum. So, the forum is now open. Do have a coffee break for the next 20 minutes or so. Thereafter, you're into parallel sessions in halls 2 and 3. Thank you all very much.
So, when you're ready, you can just close your eyes, take a breath, allow your focus to go inside. Your awareness goes inside. As you focus on slowing down the rhythm of your breath, extending the inhalation, prolonging the exhalation, so that you can move yourself to the alpha level of consciousness, which is that level of consciousness that allows you to access your subconscious thoughts. Can we live together?
Look at me, I'm getting blind, my love. They call me danger, I'm not a saint, my love. Don't try to touch me, I'm getting wild, love. I'm just a beast, and you're a child. Stop sign, one more night, and you're mine. Red light, stop sign, one more night, and you are mine. Stop teasing me, or I explode, my love. Don't pay for my drinks, I lose control, my love. No more sleazy emails, or I invade you. No more of this.